Welcome to this session of Uncovering India. It has been an honor to have you in our session, considering the stellar work that you both are doing in the area of mental health. And congratulations to both of you. An idea named COVIDAV Helpline that germinated 1 year ago has not only completed 1 year, but also is getting so big that it is getting endorsed by celebrities like Alia Bhatt. So how do you feel, Mr. Nishad, what is your take on it?
First of all, thanks, Shashwat. Thanks for having us. I think it feels great to see that, you know, I think you were the first personnel from the media space to have covered us. And yet again, here we are. That completes one full year, one full circle. Well, to be honest, what was conceptualized as just a, you know, a kind of a project, we never really thought that it's going to be taking such a move and turning out to be so big in terms of the impact that the portal has created. Definitely, I mean, you know, celebrity endorsement and collaboration by the likes of Alia Bhatt and Faye D'Souza, this is just a testimony to the fact that, yes, we've been able to do a little bit of an impact to, you know, quite a thousands of people. And that's something which also kind of brings in some sort of satisfaction to all of us that, yes, we were able to help many people in need. If we you know, go back to April last year, 2020, when we started out the platform, the whole idea was that we could reach out to maybe a few 10. And thankfully, we had the right kind of partnerships coming in. We're really thankful to the DHS, Government of Goa, Sangat, Kooj, for, you know, really helping us out in terms of empaneling as many volunteers as possible to help us, you know, scale up in this mission. So whatever we are today, it's purely because of the efforts that were put in by 100-odd volunteers that we had on board and who are still, you know, toiling it hard to offer their services for free of cost.
How do you look back at this journey of 1 year? How things have evolved? How did it evolve and how the journey has evolved over a period of 1 year? And how, where does it stand today after a year?
Sure. I think if we go back 1 year, we had developed a web platform primarily for Akshada to take care of her cases. And when we realized the traction that it is getting, we reached out to PSG, which is the Psychiatric Society of Goa, which is like the, you know, a nodal body comprising of mental health clinicians in Goa. When we reached out to them, when we had a lot of deliberations, it was figured out that, you know, we had to move fast and we had to get as many volunteers as possible. Luckily, by the likes of PSG's expertise, we were able to get hold of NGOs, you know, reputed NGOs like Sangat and Kooj on board. We had private, you know, psychiatrists like, you know, from the likes of Antarman who came on board as well to offer their services. So one side was the getting the right kind of clinicians on board, psychiatrists and psychologists and other mental health clinicians. The other side of it was on the technology part. Initially, due to the, you know, we were constrained on the time part because we had to do something very fast. So we leveraged a third-party platform like Zoom and stuff like that. But later it was realized that Zoom was facing a lot of flak because of its privacy issues and the fact that it is a China-based company and there's surveillance and other issues around that. So we decided to develop our own technology around, you know, video meetings and audio meetings and remote meetings, online consultations. So in no time, in less than a week, we rolled out our own in-house video consultation platform to make sure that, you know, patients feel secure. At the same time, the quality of service was also the same as what it was before, because end of the day, the least that you would want is to roll out your in-house platform and then see that performance has taken a hit, there is latency and the video is not clear and issues like that. So we made sure that those issues were also addressed. Once that was out, a lot of other things started happening around in the country, especially around telemedicine. We had Niti Aayog come up with telemedicine guidelines. These guidelines were actually supposed to take its own course, but a benefit out of the pandemic was that digital health started, you know, moving and accelerating like never before. We had NDHM, which was launched by the Honorable Prime Minister last August, which is the National Digital Health Mission, which basically envisages the digitalization of our health records, ensuring how we interact with hospitals and doctors in a digital way. The entire care concern is secure and convenient at the same time. So, in fact, we are also members of the NDHM. We are one of the digital partners for NDHM in terms of mental health. Besides that, there was another alliance which took form, that was the Swast Alliance, which was a congregation of all the health players, not just technology, but even the likes of Columbia Asia, Manipal Hospitals, all the large entities are a part of Swast Alliance. And we also are one of the partners of the Swast Alliance. So Swast also came up with its own app for COVID specific use cases, as well as other cases like mental health and ambulance and O2 and stuff like that. So everyone was on a war footing, and we made sure that, in terms of any support that was required for the health infrastructure, we made sure that we were up for it and we participated in it. So I think, like you said, no journey comes without its own share of problems and issues. We did face a lot of issues and problems in different directions, but it is about what kind of grit you have, what kind of passion you have to solve the problem. And finally, looking back, it's like it seems like as if we just breezed our way through that 1 year. It doesn't really feel like it's 1 year. It's still day one for us.
So, Mr. Nishad, can you take me through some numbers in terms of from April to December, what was your total number of visitors or consultations done through this system? And from January, or for example, for the matter between April to now, has there been any shooting up of numbers? Have you observed what kind of hits and visitors? Can you give me some details?
Sure. So I will not be able to share the exact numbers, primarily because of confidentiality arrangements with different partners. But a number which is public is what we did till around October last year. And till around that time, we had over 2,000 patients who had, done a consultation on the platform. And this is just first user consultations, because we also provide follow-ups and referrals. So I'm not counting that. If we go for if we just do a curve. Okay, another thing is, in fact, we did close to, I think, over 20 lakh minutes of therapy over the platform in the last, I think, till around December or so. So that's a big number. To give you a perspective on what the trend was, when we started out, obviously, we started out with a bang. I mean, there was a huge inflow of patients coming in. Many of these patients thought that we are also providing COVID consultation, which we weren't. Because of the name, they kind of thought that we are providing COVID consultation. We peaked around June, July. That's when we had a crazy amount of cases coming in every day. Somewhere around October, November, December is when things started plateauing. And we, in fact, had almost decided that, maybe around a month or so, and then we can either transition this platform into a commercial version, or we were basically deliberating on all those thoughts. And December, Jan is what, we started seeing even a drop in the number of consultations. So we thought that this is the right time to, sort of wind up the show. But the moment we saw February is when things started heating up again. I will not say it really spiked, but yes, there were increasing cases. And about a month back, say around April or so, is when things really started looking bad. And we had the same volume coming in terms of the number of patients. And in fact, even if you do a quick analysis on Twitter and social media, you will understand that this was an internal research that we did, in fact, on the sentiment analysis on Twitter across Indian youth. You'll find that the depression index, the anxiety index, has increased by more than 200% since last year. Because our understanding is that, this is again our hypothesis, is that mental health is a lagging condition. It's like when you get hurt physically, you feel the pain right there and then. But when you're affected mentally, you might not feel the pain at that moment, but you might feel that pain maybe 6 months down the line or 1 year down the line. And that is what is being manifested in the survey that we conducted. So I think things might just get bad from here as far as mental health cases are concerned. So we're just trying to see what kind of infrastructure we can set up in terms of, you know, helping all these patients out.
Thank you, Mr. Nishad. Akshada ma'am, this entire COVID situation has brought mental health as an issue in the forefront, which was missing for a long time, which was getting brushed under the carpet. We all know the that stigmatization, that reluctance regarding mental health and mental health assistance. Do you think that barrier is broken, or at least has come down from what it was earlier?
Yes, absolutely. It has come down. It's come down, but it's not completely broken. It's come down. Okay, the thing is, what I saw is, since the last year when we just were supposed to start off, before we started off with COVID AV, when the first lockdown began, the last year, March lockdown began, that was the time when I started getting calls for online consultation. And till then, even the teleconsulting platform was not very clear about the prescription. How do we send? How do we, like, you know, interact with, on which platform? Was it just WhatsApp, video call, or Zoom, whatever? So that was the time when I actually spoke to Nishan, and this thing came up. COVID, we started, and we had, like, you know, we started our consultations. What I saw was that before COVID-19, people would come in Goa. I would still say stigma is not that high as probably as compared to other states. I'm not sure. People are coming up, at least the youth is coming up with the case of depression and anxiety. But it all kind of doubled up after COVID-19. It's like, you know, they started coming up and they started getting themselves screened. They started getting themselves screened for depression and anxiety. COVID was one, and second was the Sushant Singh Rajput's case. So these were two things which I saw. And after that was the time when the youth in the age group of 20 to 30 were coming in just for screening themselves for anxiety and depression. And now after October, like the way Nishad said, when COVID began, it was not then that the whole brunt started. It started coming in only from September, October, when the work from home, staying at home, decreased communication, okay, decreased meeting people, decreased social interaction, okay, all these things when started affecting people. In September, October were the cases which started coming to us as case of depression, anxiety, these things are coming up. Work from home, I have seen a lot of cases of work from home burnouts. I've been seeing a lot of cases of in the age group of 25 to 35 where they are suffering from work from home burnout. So when you mentioned about work from home, yes, work from home is actually affecting the youth, as it is not letting them have the boundary between the personal and the professional life. It's at one room where they sit and work on their laptop, or it's at one room where they sleep also. So there's no boundary between the two. So that's what is creating a lot of burnout in the youth. So that these were the cases which I saw very commonly. Second, obviously, was COVID-19 anxiety cases, where many of them were scared that they would contract COVID, their family would contract COVID, and some of them were depressed because they got COVID and they still kept feeling that, you know, still there within, and they'll be still infected again. So these cases were very common, which came in September, October. Then by December, I saw that again, there was a drop in COVID-related cases. Our general cases were coming in. But till then, that stigma, the way you said, was, like, you know, it had come down, and the number of cases increased. Number of cases coming to the OPD increased. Now, again, from February, the second wave began, and again, there's an inflow of this COVID-19 anxiety coming in, because obviously news is that the second wave is obviously much more infectious, and it was worse than the first one. So this year, there have been a lot of cases which came in for only COVID anxiety more than last year. So this is what trend I have noticed. But yes, the way you said, stigma has surely come down. It has broken the, many people are openly speaking about it. People are openly speaking about mental disorders. People are speaking about depression, anxiety. People are talking about, people have understood the importance of being with family. People have understood the importance of having social interaction. All these things have come to light now.
Speaking about COVID, of the telemedicine platform for mental health therapy, or rather mental health consultation, to put it that way. How do you think, as a professional, as a mental health professional, has it helped you in reaching out to more people? And has those issues that were you were speaking about, those uncertainties, how to deal with this, has been ironed out now? Are we more clear about how this technology can go ahead?
Yes, somewhere it is. We are able to see a clear path now. I think COVIDAV or any other mental health platform, okay, like a virtual platform, is helping those candidates and those patients who are still having that little bit of stigma, a little bit of embarrassment or fear of going to a psychiatrist in person. That someone will see me going to this clinic, someone will come to know that I have gone to this psychiatrist. So this confidentiality thing has, like, you know, kind of, this is taken care by the, you know, virtual platform, okay? So these candidates are getting a good, they're able to kind of get good advantage with the help of this virtual platform. So they're getting good help with this. Now, how I could help them, or how other mental health professionals could help them, is that, yes, it is, one thing is that it can be done at any time of the day. Okay, we can see emergency cases just sitting virtually. Okay, if the patient is comfortable and we are able to build a rapport very well, it's saving the patient to come to the clinic. It's keeping the patient least at risk of contracting COVID-19. We are at low risk. So all these things are helping us with the virtual platform. So I think somewhere it is, yes, it is helping us. But the most important thing, people who are having the stigma are reaching out to us on these virtual platforms. So it is, like, you know, they don't have to face the, like, you know, going to the psychiatrist in person.
So what is the future of this kind of technology? Where does it, is it beneficial in the long run? Or because
I think that this is the future.
But what about the huge population that still doesn't have access to smartphones, internet? Place like Goa, where internet bandwidth connectivity is so poor. So in such places, how do more people can be reached where technology cannot reach, in terms of giving mental health aid?
Sure. So I think the real way to look at this would be to have what we call an omni-channel approach. Like you rightly said, yes, there are some areas in India, in fact, even if we speak about like Quanta, where internet penetration is still an issue, especially like if we talk about India, then yes, we have tier 2, tier 3 cities where internet penetration, data bandwidth is still not like the way it is in the cities. So we need to follow an omni-channel approach here, where we could leverage not just the online channel, but also the offline channel. But these channels are connected, which means if you go for an OPD consultation, say to a certain physical clinic in, say, Bathinda, and you happen to, you know, do a consultation with the same doctor or the same clinician online, then these consultations or these care concerns should be integrated, should be able to talk to each other. And that is the future of, you know, digital health in India today. You cannot just survive on you know, on the basis of a platform. Starting COVIDAV, whether it was a successful venture or whether it wasn't a successful venture, that's a different story. But learning experience point of view, there were a lot of notes that we really made in terms of how to progress from this point. So one observation that I likely said is, yes, you cannot survive purely on an online platform. You need an offline element to that. The other aspect is about partnerships. I mean, how deep partnerships can you strike with the ecosystem? Like here, we were fortunate to have a very proactive Directorate of Health Services. Can we take this to other states? Can other governments look at this, look at partnering with this? Why is it that we don't have IPHB coming on board over here? I mean, you have to be progressive at this point in time. We have to put our petty differences aside and make sure that, you know, we have look progressive and make sure that you come on board on these platforms like these. So it's about that. It's about what kind of alliances you can strike with other bodies. So I think it's in that direction.
Ma'am, what is your take on it as a mental health professional? How do you see what Ms. Nishad just said?
I agree with what he said. See, the larger number of professionals we get on board, we'll be able to provide better service and more to more number of people. So I think what he's saying is, I agree with all of that.
Considering that this is a completely a voluntary working model, there is no monetary incentive for medical professionals who are putting their time in this kind of activity, taking time out. So do you think that will remain an encouragement for mental health professionals to continue render services without any kind of a monetary incentive in the long run if this thing continues?
Yeah, I think it's a great question. So as far as free or pro bono services are concerned, we are at the behest, we are at the, we have to rely on partnerships with NGOs, like Sangat, for example. Most of our partners, whoever we have, come from Sangat, and Sangat being an NGO, has offered to, you know, do these consultations pro bono as part of their pro bono strategy. We also have Kuj, which is again a mental health NGO. We have Antarman, we have PSG. So all of these clinicians that we have on board are currently offering this as pro bono. But as you know, we might have to live with the virus. We might have to coexist with the virus. So we cannot really have pro bono services being offered 24/7 throughout the year. While maybe a portion of the services will still remain free, but we definitely are looking at different monetization aspects. We're trying to see if we can partner with private bodies who can fund us in terms of the CSR funding, or maybe receive grants, or maybe even go in for institutional funding. So we are looking at monetization options. But right now, given that the pandemic has again taken an ugly turn, we are putting thoughts into how we can really service users at this point in time.
So what would be your message for our viewers, starting with Nishad ji, from you first, and from technology reach and usage point of view, and ma'am, from your mental health professional and services point of view? Each one of you could give me your message for the society.
Sure. So I always believe that technology is not the end. Technology is just a means to an end. So just having a platform, just having a state-of-the-art technology will not really solve problems. Like, it's like saying that you have a food delivery app, but you don't have any restaurants to serve, or you don't have good restaurants to serve. There's no point about what kind of technology you use there. So same applies to any kind of health tech platforms as well. No matter what investments you make in terms of technology, but if you haven't thought about your business strategy, if you haven't thought about your go-to-market strategy, then obviously you will falter along the lines. I believe that technology is going to be a key enabler for digital health ecosystems, whether we are talking about wearable devices like your Fitbits and Apple Watches, or whether you're talking about digital health in terms of telemedicine and counseling over technology platforms. Technology will remain a key enabler, and that's how things are going to progress.
And mental health, per se, I feel, Mr. Shashwat, is that, yes, the way the stigma is going down, I think it should go down further, and we should actually look into that, as professionals, and maybe even you all can help us, media people can help us in getting the stigma down and completely break it at once, so that people can, more and more people can reach out to platforms like us for help, and we are able to help them. So I think we all together can help a lot, in terms of mental health. We should come together and do it for us.
So do you think a model like this can be used in the long run to reach out to more masses and get them to get the benefits of technology and mental health services under one platform?
Yes, it does. It will absolutely help. The way I said that, with the help of technology, we'll be able to reach a larger population, maybe some rural populations, some people who cannot reach out to doctors in cities or distant places. We can reach out to those people also virtually. So I think, yes, obviously it's going to help.
Okay, Thank you so much, Mr. Nishad and Akshada ma'am, for joining me for this interactive session.
Thank you.
It was glad to have you on board, and wishing all of you very best of luck with your venture. And I pray and hope that it goes bigger and more people get benefit of it.
Thank you so much, Ashwath.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
It was great to be there. Thanks for having us again.
My honor. Bye-bye. My honor. Bye-bye.